What's up, Collider TV Talk fans? We are here with a special guest. We're going to air this, obviously, during the Walking Dead review show, but we're also going to air it during TV Talk, so you guys are getting us twice. Josh McDermott, a.k.a. Dr. Eugene Porter, is here talking with us all about The Walking Dead. Josh, welcome.
Dr. Smarty Pants. Actually, I'm Negan now.
Oh, yes, you're Negan.
I'm Negan, which is
the quickest
amazing.
Negan turn in the history of the show.
I know. I'm so sad that we had to let Jeffrey Dean Morgan go, but I'm happy to pick up that torch and run with it now. You know?
How has this season been for you? I mean, obviously, since you came on in season four, you've been a fan favorite character, someone to love, someone to hate, someone to be confused by. How has this season been different from you for you as compared to the others? Because you're losing, you know.
Yeah, we lost a few people, especially, you know, like when I first started on the show, before I even flew out to Georgia to start shooting, mm-hmm. Steven Yeun was emailing me saying, hey, here's my number. Call me if you need anything. Like, we're working together on Friday.
Yeah.
Which you don't get that on most shows when you step into, especially a hit show. You know, the lead actors are so humble and welcoming like that, mm-hmm. which was cool. And to fly out to Georgia with Michael Cudlitz, who I'm very close with, as well as Christian Serratos, like we formed a bond.
Yeah.
And like a lot of that is missing this season for us. You know, it's I mean, that's what happens. Like we take as actors, we take jobs and we, you know, come and go and things like that. But it's been difficult. At the same time, like Michael and Steven especially, their fingerprints are all over this show. So they're gone, but it doesn't feel like they're gone. We still talk a lot, and they show up on set every once in a while. We see them at fan conventions and things like that. Sure. But it's just, it's off. It's different, you know?
Weird. Yeah.
What about this here? Because clearly you're embracing it, and you rock it well even when you're not on the show. But
I mean, I have to.
But exactly, like, do you have to, or is there any kind of
situation? I
thought it
was extensions, to be
honest. Well, that's what I thought, because if you want to take other roles in your free time.
I mean, every role, I think I auditioned for the role of a cop in the new Fargo, and I'm like, well, I'm not getting this. I like fluffed it out a little more. I'm like, let's just let them know exactly what they're looking at here. Yeah, unless it's like a role of like a drug dealer or a guy who doesn't give a crap about his life. Am I allowed to swear?
Yeah, of course.
I gotta censor myself.
So they let you keep it for Twin Peaks? It's Twin Peaks appropriate?
You're bringing up Twin Peaks. I can't talk about that.
Can't help it.
They're more secretive than The Walking Dead.
Yeah.
Like, I get an email once a week, like, don't say anything. And so I'm like, okay, geez.
And a guy shows up at your door dressed in all black and hands you... Yeah.
Yeah. It's very scary to be a part of that world. I'll tell you, I regret it every minute of every day. But yeah, I have the mullet, man. It's I'm a blonde. I'm a natural blonde, and I didn't have a mullet. My hair was like yours, yeah. Josh, and it's maybe a little better. My hair is slightly better.
I'm gonna give it to you.
A little more beautiful. Sure.
I feel like we need to make a bet where if you lose the bet, we make you grow a mullet.
No, because I'm from Pittsburgh, where the mullet was created, basically.
Right.
And it's still a very well-respected.
Oh, I was just in Pittsburgh, man. Yeah. And I was a king.
They give you the key to the city as soon as you're off the plane with a mullet. You know, Jaromir Jagr, our hockey player, whose mullet is in the Hall of Fame. Now you're next to him.
Yeah, I'm very excited to be so highly regarded in the city of Pittsburgh. Greg Nicotero, one of our executive producers, is from Pittsburgh, he was telling me, he's like, "Hey, man, you're gonna be really loved in Pittsburgh." I was like, "Let's do this," and we showed up, man. And you're right.
Yeah.
You get off the plane, and it's like the Lion King. Like they were all bowing. I was like, "Okay, I get it."
They just took the mullet and raised it up.
Yeah, they carried me on their shoulders to the baggage claim.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's having the mullet. I don't know, man.
Do you think after you're done playing Eugene, after The Walking Dead has made its run, will you keep the mullet, or do you think you'll go back to
I don't know what to do. I mean, that's like the thing that I'm sitting here worried, like, what should I do? Like, Michael Cudlitz, I'll start a band, yeah. Like, I want to do a Huey Lewis cover band. I think that would be great.
I'll be part of the news. Just put me in.
Just do it. Well, I play the saxophone,
amazing.
So I want to be Johnny Cola.
Yeah.
Because I think he had a bit of a mullet.
He did. That was my first CD I ever bought, was Huey Lewis in the News.
Which one?
The
Sports?
Greatest Hits.
No. Oh, Greatest Hits?
Yeah, my parents, I mean, like, I was 8 CDs. My mom was like, what do you want? I was like, Huey Lewis. She's like, all right.
How old are you?
35.
Okay. Yeah. What was your first CD? Do you remember?
Oh, God. Probably not my first, but I just picture my Sleepaway Camp collection, which is probably No Doubt and like NSYNC and Spice Girls. Clearly, I am a child of the 90s.
Like
I played saxophone too. Does that give me any credit in this situation?
I love you. I was gonna make out with Josh, but now.
What saxophone do you play?
Tenor.
Oh, okay. That was the only one I didn't play. I still have my baritone.
You can.
And it's just as big as I am.
There's saxophones you can play. Any of them.
Well, you can play any of them if you have the money to buy them.
But you have a
rent them.
You have a Barry sax?
I still own my baritone sax.
It's bigger than you.
It is heavier than I am, too. I had to wear like a harness to actually hold it up.
In all the years I've known Perry, I've not known that she plays a baritone saxophone.
I still have my baritone, and I still have this really badass black alto saxophone that I love.
That's like a Kenny G special, right? Isn't Kenny G the alto?
It's beautiful. Soprano. But it sounds amazing.
You're embarrassing yourself.
I'm sorry.
That's really hot, actually.
Yeah.
I kind of love that.
Yeah, we're walking into something here. All right.
I need to save this clip and put it on all my dating profiles.
Did you do marching band too?
I didn't do marching band. I did a lot of pit orchestra though.
Oh, okay. Yeah. No jazz.
Jazz band as well. Yeah. Yeah. A lot of jazz. I'm not good at improv though.
Oh, really?
Are you good at improv?
Yeah. That's all I was good at.
That's a completely different level of playing an instrument. I feel like it's one thing to study and read sheet music, but if you can improv, that's legit.
Are you a Careless Whisper kind of guy? Do we get into the Careless Whisper?
That was my first CD.
Okay. There you go.
No, I don't even know what that is. What is it?
Still don't get it.
That's Kenny G, right?
Yeah.
Do we have to edit that out? Do you have the rights to that? I love it. He even did like the fingers.
Come on. I can play air instruments like nobody else.
Perry,
I swear.
Tell me this. Does this drive you nuts? And I'm sorry. I feel like I'm derailing this interview.
No, it's fine.
When people pretend to do the saxophone and they put their thumb and they do this, does that drive you nuts?
Drives me nuts, and I find it super awkward.
Well, it's a reed instrument.
Okay, no, Josh, but you're sitting, you're just doing this.
Possible.
This is fine.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is fine, because people are going to do air guitar or whatever. Sure. But like,
Def Leppard one on
when you put
drum.
Your thumb in your mouth, like it's the mouthpiece. That's what's so, I'm just like, stop it. You look so stupid.
The pet peeves of a saxophonist we're learning all about.
Oh my God.
Let's try and jump back to the walking band.
Oh yeah,
just
I'm
for
sorry.
A second.
This is
just
why
for
I'm
a
here.
Second. Although I could talk about sax solos all day.
Eugene needs a sax solo at some point. Negan's got one of those, right?
Probably. They've probably scavenged one.
Negan's own marching band.
It's amazing they haven't had you play the saxophone in the show yet. You find one in an abandoned house, and then it's like, oh, Eugene can play the sax.
I almost did on my last series. It was a sitcom called Retired at 35 with George Segal, who's now on the Goldbergs.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Jessica Walter from Arrested Development. And George Segal's known for playing his banjo. And we were talking one day. I told him I played the sax, and he's like, oh, let's have him write an episode where we start a Dixieland jazz band. I got so freaking scared, man. I was like, there's something I haven't played since I was like in, you know, college or high school, but like just playing the saxophone at all with someone else playing another instrument and having like making sure it's good is terrifying. Well, so I don't know that I want to do that on The Walking Dead.
I don't know. I think we might have to. I mean, Greg Nicotero, Pittsburgh guy. I know his brother. We can make a call there. So I want to know, because obviously, what was the audition process like for you? Did you come in with a Southern accent, or did they tell you to do a Southern accent, or did you create that character?
They asked me to do the Southern accent, and I thought I was doing a Southern accent. Mm-hmm. I feel like every time I was trying it, at first it sounded really cartoony, like. Mm-hmm. Hey, I'm gonna go like that sound. Gonna play me a secret saxophone. Like I felt like that's what it sounded like. So I'm like, well, I'll just do it slight. And they go, man, you were really great. We'd really like you to do a Southern accent. I'm like, oh, I thought I was doing it. Okay, I'll bump it up a little bit. So the next audition, I did a little more, and they're like, you're great. We'd really like you to do a Southern accent. I'm like, holy crap, I'm going to lose this job because I'm not doing a Southern accent. So I had to get with a dialect coach, and I still feel like it's cartoony at times.
Because it's like that perfect monologue that some of the words like may not be Southern, but the way you say certain other words, it's totally believable.
Yeah, well, it's funny when you get with a dialect coach, they tell you there's certain words that you can tell if the person is actually a native speaker from that area.
Right.
And so I like key in on those words and that's it. So like a British, if you're doing a British accent, they don't say like, where have you been? They say, where have you been?
Yeah, okay.
And it's like, oh, well, that's all I need. Like, I want to know those little words so that someone doesn't think I'm a fraud.
And you don't have to like improv the Southern accent. They're giving you scripts, so it's not.
Yeah.
I know nothing about accents, but I feel like it's Eugene's cadence that is very specific to his character.
Yeah, he's really monotone. I kind of based that on my brother. Like, he would be He's so like even. Yeah, well, he gets so mad. He goes when I say this because he's like, stop telling people that. Because like I'm like, it's like he'll be super excited. I'm like, you excited about this? He's like, yeah, I'm really pumped. like he is excited, but that's how he is. He's like, he goofs around with people. So he was working at Costco. He was like driving a forklift, mm-hmm. and his name's Zach. And he had convinced everyone that he was Russian, and he wore like a name tag that said Dmitry, had like a Russian Cossack, and he would only speak Russian to them, or would say like "nyet" and like all that. So like even like members at Costco were like, "Hey, where's the coffee grounds?" And he's like, "You know, he's speaking Russian," and he was just screwing with people. So I start telling everyone that I based my Eugene's accent on my brother Zach, yeah. And he was so mad. He's like, please stop telling people that. You're ruining the thing I have going at work. And like,
that was him. That's him alter mad. Ego. Yeah.
That was his outlet, I guess.
Oh, that's incredible. So this, I want to know, I mean, okay, obviously Walking Dead, huge fan following. I mean, an unbelievably, diet, like everybody lives and breathes on episode by episode. It's one of those shows. What's been like one of your favorite fan experiences, or like at maybe like a Comic-Con or something? One of the things that when you first got the role, like, holy cow, this is something else.
I mean, honestly, every fan convention we do is special because a lot of times when we do the panels too, to just see how many people have turned out, especially when we go internationally. This week, a bunch of us are heading to London. You know, our show airs within the same week internationally, mm-hmm. as it does in the U.S., and we tend to forget that the fan base is just as rabid overseas, and that's really been the most fun. I was just in Asia, and we did all these fan events, and people were going apeshit, and yeah. I was like, this is really special, you know? That
are they on the same season in Asia, or are they?
They're in the same season. Wow. It's a big deal to them that it airs on Monday. It airs in the U.S. first, but... because of the international dateline and stuff, they're able to say that it airs the same day U.S. Right. And so yeah. That's like a big deal for them, because a lot of Western shows, they have to wait like 2 years.
Then
they just pirate it anyway, which is bad. Don't pirate television shows. But
or the
movies.
Mullet, though, could be a pirate haircut, too. You could go out as pirate roles.
There you go. Why am I going out for Fargo?
Although you would fit in Fargo season 3 real well.
I hope so. Man, I really want that job.
Saying it now. I love Fargo, too. It's an incredible
Fargo's
show.
Such a great show. But yeah. Not as good as The Walking Dead.
Of course. Yeah. Of course.
But the fans have just been incredible. I mean, we more on the international thing, like Michael Cudlitz and I went to France, and a bunch of fans figured out where we were staying, and they start calling their friends, and then we leave the hotel, and they start chasing us down the street. I mean, those are like...
I like how you seem happy about that.
Yeah.
It's kind of exciting. I mean, the last show I was on, nobody watched, and now to be on a show that everybody watches is pretty special.
Yeah.
So are you aware of what happens in other episodes that you're not in? Like, not to get into spoilers yet, I assume we'll do that eventually, but, you know, people are separate. You're not in every episode. Do you know what's going on? Do you get those scripts?
Yeah, I know what episode Daryl dies. Is that what you were asking?
Yeah, specifically that.
Next episode.
I'm glad we cleared that up.
The series regulars know... You know, they get all the scripts. I think, the guest stars, the people that kind of fly in for the episodes, I think they only get their
scene,
scene, okay. Which is difficult for them to do. Stephen Ogg, who plays Simon the Savior, we also know him from, he was in Westworld and GTA. Yeah. They don't give him the full script, so he shows up and he's like, dude, tell me what's going on? Why am I saying this? And so we have to, like, coach him through it. It's kind of weird.
Yeah.
As secretive as the show is, I kind of like that. You know, I don't want to know everything because I feel like it muddies it so much and doesn't give me the freedom to do what I want to do.
Can you throw somebody under the bus? Is there any regular that gets those scripts and just doesn't feel like doing their homework?
Nah. I really wish there was someone. I feel like everybody.
Dean Morgan. He's out.
Jeffrey Dean Morgan. Yeah. Now he shows up, doesn't know his lines, and, you know.
Classic.
No, everybody's a real pro. I mean, I think nobody... The interesting thing is, for me especially, when I showed up, this was my favorite show. Mm-hmm. So, like, I didn't want to be the guy who shows up to his favorite show and ruins it. So, the more, you know, people like Andrew Lincoln and Norm and Melissa McBride, like, they weren't fans of the show when they started. So, obviously, it didn't exist. But now everybody coming in is, like, a huge fan, and I think they just really want to make sure that they get their homework and stuff like that. You know, everybody's a pro.
Is I've heard some funny like horror stories from the people that have to be dressed up as the walkers. Do you have any like funny stories of featured background complaining about the amount of time spent in makeup?
No, we don't really talk to them, to be honest. I mean, they have makeup on. They can't, you know, sometimes there's so much makeup on, they have to, like, drink a smoothie through a straw, and that's their lunch, you know, because they're just, like, they don't want to remove their face.
Yeah.
And we can't really understand what they're saying because it's all covered up. But a lot of times it's, you know, some of these walkers are, like, some of our special effects makeup artists.
Okay.
Who, like, we have this guy named Jake Garber. He's, like, 7 feet tall. He's just this monster of a man. Does a lot of Quentin Tarantino's special effects makeup and stuff like that, and he's in a lot of Tarantino's movies too because he's this big imposing guy. So whenever there's in the script it says big, large, imposing walker, we know it's going to be Jake.
Oh wow!
And so we like to walk up and make fun of him and goof around with him, and he can't talk to us because he's got, you know, makeup over his mouth and everything. Yeah. But the makeup artists are fantastic.
Yeah,
just absolutely amazing. I love. I was just talking about it. With someone else, like if I wasn't an actor, I'd probably do special effects makeup because it's phenomenal.
Yeah.
It's so cool.
Yeah,
it's an art. It's
it
crazy.
Really is.
I mean, probably on Walking Dead, almost more so than any other show. It's like I wish I could have a coffee table book of just all the different walkers I've seen.
Yeah. I mean,
that's a pretty good idea.
I know, isn't it?
Yeah. I want to convince them. So we have these, like, you know, test shots where if, like, Eugene had a bunch of bruising, so I had to go down to set and they had to do the bruising and we had to get it approved. Like, you know, we want more bruising or less bruising. And we take pictures and they print them out and they put them in this lookbook that every show has a lookbook.
Of course.
Those should be coffee table books, especially with our show, with all the test images of, like, what a walker, what they might be, the rejects, things like that would be amazing. Yeah. Give the money to charity.
I love it. Because, honestly, like, from the water zombie in season two to, you know, the one that just fell apart in the last episode.
Yeah.
Like, it's really and truly.
The one with the spikes?
Yeah.
Which was Gino Crognoli, one of our another one of our special effects makeup artists. Like, this poor guy had to, we had to, like, build that suit specific to someone. So it's like, well, sorry, Gino, you're here every day, so we're just gonna make you the spiky head.
Did you go
walker.
To set that day? Because you weren't in that.
I wasn't in. No, I didn't know what day they were shooting it. I wasn't able to get back in time. I was very much regretting that. Because
I was gonna
was
say
because awesome.
We you know we were talking about this is one of the first Eugene standalone episodes, if not the first, and it's so many episodes. You know. Are spaced out, so we may see you, and then we don't see you for, like, another 2 or 3 weeks, right?
Mm-hmm.
Are there certain episodes that you can pinpoint that are like, God, I wish I was in that episode?
Yeah, I mean, or at least just having a larger presence, you know, or wish that I was a part of a different storyline. I mean, I would love to see Eugene part of the kingdom.
Yeah.
You know, I think him interacting with a tiger might be kind of funny.
Agreed.
You know, we saw Daryl petting the tiger in the last couple of episodes. Like, let's see what would happen if Eugene got the tiger. Probably take a swipe at the mullet. We regret it. Yeah, you know, my favorite, absolute favorite episode happened before I showed up was in season three when they went to Morgan's apartement and he had all that writing on the wall and he had gone crazy. Favorite episode, and I wish I was a part of the show then so I could have, even if I wasn't in that episode, just to go to set to watch that happen because Lenny James and Andrew Lincoln together, I mean, it's
incredible.
It's a piece of work. They're beautiful, beautiful people.
Yeah.
Can we talk about this episode?
Yeah, let's talk.
My God. I have so many questions about just, like, shooting this
Lay
episode,
it on me.
Too. Well, I mean, what does real life, as in on set, Negan's compound look like? Is it just one big facility like that, or are there different sets?
There are stages. There are studio stages. Mm-hmm. It's also the same set that was the prison.
Yeah.
Which, you know, I've been an actor for a long time. I know that they build sets, and when I first showed up, and the prison still hadn't been torn down, I was like, but this is fake? Like, I thought it was a real prison, you know? But they've built they build the sanctuary. They just kind of put a facade up over the stages and that sort of thing. So it takes up probably 2 or 3 stages and with different sets in there. It's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
They have a maze of, like, the dark hallway, but it's basically just a box. Mm. But the way they shoot it makes it look like this maze, like you can't get out and everything. It's really cool.
You need one heck of a DP. And I forget who the director of your episode was, but one of my favorite things about the episode was the way the beginning was shot, where, I mean, Eugene is terrified, and you sell that well, but at the same time, his conversations with, what's her name? Linsley something?
Linsley Register.
Yes. Yeah. your conversation with her, it's shot in a way where it's just like the two of you standing there in one frame talking it out, and just the comedic beats in that are so on point.
Yeah, Kari Skoglund directed it, and she's an amazing editor too. And that was a fun scene to shoot. I mean, it's even just reading it on the page, you just understand completely what, you know, Scott Gimple is going for. And I love shooting that scene, and Lindsay is amazing.
She was fantastic.
I
mean,
she's so good.
Her first job was in House of Cards. Mm. I don't want to spoil it, but she was in the scene where Kevin Spacey got shot, mm-hmm. right? And she's like a student protester. And I had watched that episode the night before. The next day, I meet Lindsay to like work with her, and I was like, "What? I just watched you last night." It's like she's been she's like fresh out of college and working her butt off. She's amazing.
It's incredible how she makes such a big impression. That's what amazes me with Walking Dead is just you have this huge ensemble with regulars, and then you add all these people around them, and you don't forget them for the most part.
Yeah.
Sometimes we do, and then people pick on us about it, but often we do remember everybody.
There are a ton of characters, and we talked about it on the after show, is whenever you bring in new cast members to the show, it doesn't matter what they look like or where they fit in the story, you gravitate towards them. It's like this new mystery. And I think that's what The Walking Dead has done so well, is that when the characters come on, you're like, all right, now what's going on here?
Right.
You want to figure out this mystery that we've been given.
Yeah, the show does a good job at casting against type. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm a comedian. I've mostly done comedies, and here I am doing my first drama, a character that I've never done. Andrew J. West, the guy who played the cannibal, Gareth, same thing. Like, he played a very dark character, but he's usually playing like a ditzy dumb guy or whatever, you know? They like to cast against type. Lindsay, she's playing this badass savior. She's usually like someone's daughter, like just a schoolgirl or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I think because they're playing against type so much, there is that mystery that's there. So like, even though the character's coming in, you want to know more about them. There's something else going on that we can't put our finger on, but I think it's because it's the actor playing something they haven't played before.
For sure. And it's like Dwight too, Austin
Emilio.
Everybody Wants Him. I think that was the first time I had ever seen him, and that's kind of like a comedy.
Totally different.
Yeah. And what you get to do in that episode in particular is kind of like a cool marriage of what you've already accomplished with nailing the drama of Walking Dead, but then Eugene has that charm that makes him fun to watch.
He's a bit quirky, he's I love watching him interact with new characters. I mean, you look at someone like Rosita or Tara, you know, Abraham, people who know him, they kind of just roll their eyes, and that's always a fun interaction too. But to interact with people that don't really understand Eugene, to me, is like comedy gold. Even though we're not necessarily going for the jokes, it's still very funny and interesting to me.
Well, I think you, Eugene, and Jeffrey Dean Morgan, Negan, are basically our only comic relief at this point, right? And Jerry in the Kingdom.
Jerry in the Kingdom, maybe Alana Masterson, Tara, a little bit too, you know? She killed me when Rosita was diffusing the dynamite. She's like, okay, I'm going to step away here. You know, they never write jokes, but just, you know, whatever they do write is definitely more for the character, and just in the way that's delivered could be funny to people.
All right, should we get some, try and get some spoilers here?
Let's get some spoilers. Okay. Let's do it.
Well, I mean, the thing that interests me most about Eugene in this episode is the way you capture everything we know about him from previous seasons, yet we see him take some steps forward in new directions. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the episode, it's still tough to figure out what exactly is going through his head. Or are we going to, you obviously can't answer this, but what can you tease us in terms of, is Eugene changing in a way that's going to lead him more towards Negan, or is he still going to be loyal to the characters we know he loves?
Yeah, that I don't know, because I didn't want to know. I told Scott Gimple, our showrunner, like, I don't want to know where his like true allegiance lies. If he's, you know, faking this, if he's a Trojan horse, which is exciting to me. It gives me a little more freedom to do things. And, you know, just coming up, I think obviously he's made some decisions that are pretty profound and are going to have an impact. And I think that those impacts are going to not only be felt within him, but through other communities. And I think that they, he'll also, you know, just be confronted with those decisions. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, are these the right decisions? It's exciting. I think the show's heading in a great direction, and you know, we're starting to see everybody start to come together. You know, Rick is, we found a new community, the Garbage Pail Kids, and
is that what we were calling the Junkyard Posse?
The Junkyard Posse. Yeah, nice. Yeah, I think on set we were calling them the Heapsters.
The Heapsters, yeah.
But yeah, they you know, there's a lot of mystery going on, and it's all going to converge at some point.
Yeah, this
and,
war is coming, huh?
Well, that's what it looks like. Yeah. That's what it looks like, man.
I love it. Anything else?
There's so many things that I want to know, but I obviously don't want to spoil the show for me. I mean, I'm obviously hoping that the end of that episode leads to more interaction between Dwight and Eugene, because we were talking about it on the after show. They're two completely different people, yet right. One of the greatest things about this, and I want to say, I'm not just saying this because you're here. This was I said it on the review before I knew you were coming. That was really one of my favorite episodes. And the cool thing is that Eugene and Dwight are two completely different people, but that episode is structured so well because there's very interesting parallels happening between the two of them. And I kind of want to see that continue.
Yeah, absolutely. They're both in the same boat, but coming at it from different directions. And they, I just love that little interaction at the end where he's like, hey, I don't know if you caught my name while I was biting your dick, but it's Eugene. It's like, that goes back to like Eugene interacting with people that don't really know who he is. Yeah. It's like Eugene's kind of like, all right, well, we're both Negan, like we're on the same page. And Dwight, just his answer of just yeah is so loaded.
Yeah,
you know. And I love that, and I hope that there's more between those two characters, because you know, like I said, they're both in the same boat, but they're definitely not headed in the same direction.
I love the fact that, I mean, you may not, I know you said you wanted to be in the kingdom, but I love the fact that you're at Negan's compound now, because now we have this window into what could possibly happen. We don't know what's going to happen. Or like you said, are you the Trojan horse? But also, we've never really seen Eugene go full. You know, you talk about the smelter, you talk about making the bullets, you show the experiments, you're playing the Atari 2400. Like, this is, we're finally getting this, like, pure Eugene.
Yeah, we've seen a glimpse of little things, like his interactions with women, which I always find funny.
Hysterical.
You know, because this guy thinks he's George Clooney.
Yeah.
You know, but it's like, he gets shut down, and he's like, yeah, nailed it. You know, he doesn't know. And then his intelligence, not just in terms of, you know, like talking about an operational smelter or doing the science experiments, but like his intelligence of being able to play that chess match, mm-hmm. intellectually, you know, getting over on someone, to see all of those things converge into one episode is really cool. Cause I think before we've only seen it one at a time.
Yeah.
Does he blame Rosita at all being there? Do you think he thinks about her and that she's
That's a great question.
The reason?
I don't think so, because I think he knew it was going to happen. And if we remember back in episode 7 of the first half of the season, he told her, like, I'm going to make this bullet for you. I know it's inevitable, but all I'm trying to do is slow you down because someone's going to get hurt. And even though you're the one who's willing to like sacrifice, there's no guarantee you're going to be the one. He was afraid that someone else might die, including himself. And we saw that, you know, Spencer and Olivia both died. He gets taken. I don't think it's like, poor, you know, how dare she? I'm so mad at her. I think he's sad because he was right. And he's the one that got taken, but thankfully he hasn't died yet. So we'll see, you know, how this all comes about.
Man, this has been a ton of fun, man. Thank you so much.
This was great, guys.
This is great.
Yeah.
You know, we talked about it before the camera started rolling, but if you want to come and be on the season finale after show with us, we'd love to have you or any of the after shows going forward.
Yeah, I told you I would let you know after this interview, and I think I'll
love
pass.
Cool.
He's
put you on the spot now.
Great, all right. Great. Josh, seriously, though, congratulations on everything. We love your character.
Thank you very much.
And I know all the fans, The Walking Dead fans, all our collective people that love watching this show, loved having you here. So, again, if you ever want to come back, you're more than welcome.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, awesome.
Thank you, guys.
Josh McDermott, guys. Dr. Eugene Porter. Woo-hoo! See you next time.
Hey, guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.